Hello, this is NanoDano at devdungeon.com with part 2 of making a Discord bot in Python 3. In this video, we'll look at making a better bot using a better way of defining commands, along with some examples on how to respond with random messages, connect with external APIs, run background tasks, and change the bot status to make it look like it's playing a game. If you followed the last video, then you should already have a Discord server and a bot account to test with. If you do not already have a bot created, check out the first video, which walks you through the process of creating a Discord server, creating a bot user, and creating a simple Python script to run it. This is the code we ended with last time. I want to show you a different way of doing it, though, so let's start with a new blank file. You should already have discord.py installed, but if you don't, install it with python-m pip install discord.py. The first thing we need to do is create a client. This time, instead of using discord.client like the previous example, we're going to use discord.ext.commands.bot class. We'll have to import it first from discord.ext.commands import bot. Then we can create an instance of the bot. If you try to run it just like this, it will give you an error and say the bot is missing a required argument, the command prefix. So let's fix that. Let's create a variable at the top of the file called bot prefix. For this example, I'm going to use a question mark as the bot prefix. Any message received that starts with this character will be considered a bot command. You can actually allow multiple prefixes by storing them all within a tuple, like this. Let's add the exclamation point too. After creating this bot prefix variable, we need to pass it as the command prefix argument when creating the bot object. Great, now we have a client object to work with, or the bot object specifically. This isn't enough to get the bot to run though. We have to explicitly tell the client to run with the run command, so we can put that at the bottom of the file, and we need to pass the run function the bot's token. Let's create a variable at the top named token and store a variable there. The reason I put these variables at the top is because we might want to change them later, and it's easier to have them together up at the top rather than scattered throughout the code. I'm using all capital letters to signify that they are meant to be treated as constants that never change throughout execution of the program. If you need to get your bot's token again, go to discordapp.com/developers and go to the My Apps section on the left. Click on your app and scroll down to the bot user. Click Reveal to reveal your token and copy and paste it into your source code. Okay, so now that our bot is all set up and ready to go, we have a client that will connect using our token. We can run it and verify it doesn't crash. It won't do anything, but the bot should show up in the user list to let us know that it's actually working. When we quit the program, it will take a minute before the bot goes offline again. So what is the difference between this and the previous example? Well, instead of using the default client, we used the bot class. This class provides an easier way of creating bot commands. Let's just demonstrate it so you can see what I mean. Create a new function and call it 8ball. Give this function a decorator of client.command with the parentheses. You want to put this function after the client is created, but before the call to run. Because the commands are triggered asynchronously, we also need to add an async keyword before the function's def. Alternatively, you could use the decorator of asyncio.coroutine. Let's have this command return a random response. Let's create a list of possible responses first. We'll try to copy some of the classic 8ball messages. Not just yes or no, but yes, possibly, unlikely, things like that. After we define our possible responses, we want to pick one at random and have it sent back as a message. make a call to client.say. This will have the bot respond in the same channel or chat that the message was received. We're going to return a random choice based on our possible responses. We'll also have to import random. We can now run it and test it out. If we try ?8ball, it should trigger our function. This is nice, but it would be better if we could just type the number 8 instead of writing it out. Let's go back to the code. We can't just rename the function itself to 8ball with the number 8 because function names can't start with a number. What we can do is specify the command that triggers the function by modifying the decorator of client.command. Let's set the named parameter of name to 8ball, the way that we actually want to call it from the chat room. It is also worth noting that there is one default command that comes with bots, and that is the help command. Since our bot is currently prefixed with the exclamation point and the question mark, you can try both of those out. Try ?help and !help, and it will give you a list of all the commands. You can add a description and a brief help message to each command. Those messages are displayed in the help screens. You can add the description and brief named parameters to the client.command decorator of the function. Let's try those out now. The help command by itself lists all the commands with the brief value. If you run help with the name of the specific command, you'll get the full description. You can also add aliases if you want a command to be triggered by multiple keywords. Let's demonstrate that by passing a list of aliases to the decorator. Now, when we run the help command, we will see the list of all aliases available for the command. Why don't we also have the 8ball function mention the user who requested the call? To do this, we need to append to the message. Let's add context.message.author.mention. We also need to modify our function arguments and the decorator because this context object doesn't exist yet. We need to modify the decorator to add passContext equals true. And then the first argument of the function also needs to be context. This will provide the context information about the sender and the message so that we can use it within our function. So let's try it out and make sure it works. When you trigger a bot command, you can also pass arguments to the command. Let's create a new function that will calculate a square value where you multiply a number by itself. It's a contrived example, but it will make the point. Create a new function named square, give it the client.command decorator, and give it the async tag. We also want to add an argument to the function. We can name it whatever we want, and we can put as many as we want, but let's just put one for now and call it number. We have to convert the argument to an actual number before we can multiply it, so cast it to an integer and multiply it by itself. Then we'll have the client respond with the answer, but we'll have to convert the number back to a string. Let's try it out to make sure it works. Now that we've looked at how to create custom commands, let's look at some of the event triggers that we can hook into. There are many triggers we can use. Let's take a look at the documentation for a few examples. Here's the link to the official documentation for the discord.py library. This link goes right to the event reference where it gives you a list of all of the events that you can hook into. It also tells you what parameters that each function gets. So let's look through some of these. We've got onReady, onResumed, onError, onMessage, onSocket, rawReceive, onMessageDelete, onMessageEdit, onReactionAdd, onReactionRemove, onReactionClear, onChannelDelete, on member join, on member remove, on member update, on server join. There's an action for almost everything. Let's go back and look at onMessage edit and onMessage delete. If you look at the function definitions here, you'll see what arguments are passed. For example, onMessage edit gets two parameters, before and after. The onMessage delete only gets one parameter, the message itself. Let's add an onReady function just to log when the bot has successfully connected. Create a function called onReady and give it the client.event decorator as well as the async tag like all the others. Let's have the onReady function simply print out a message that say we're logged in with the username. There are a few other things we can do besides just react to events. For example, we can change the bot's status and make it look like it's playing a game. Why don't we do that? Let's set the bot status in the onReady function to make it look like it's playing a game. Just add a call to await client.changePresence. We need to set the game parameter to a game object, so we'll create one on the fly right here. You might need to import discord.game. So far, our bot has only interacted with the Discord server. We can add richer features to the bot by reaching out to external APIs and pulling in information. Why don't we demonstrate this with another custom command called Bitcoin? It will reach out to Coinbase and get the current price in US dollars. Create a new function named Bitcoin with the async tag and the client.command decorator. The requests library makes HTTP requests really easy, so let's first make sure requests is installed with python-m pip install requests. And let's add an import for requests at the top of the Python file. Back in the Bitcoin function, let's set the URL to Coinbase's API endpoint, and then let's make a GET request to it. On the response, call the JSON function, and then extract the value that we need. Then we'll take that and send it back to the user using client.say. Remember to put the await keyword in front of the call to client.say, since this is all asynchronous. Let's try it out. When we run the Bitcoin command, it should tell us what the current price is. The one last thing I want to cover in this example is background tasks. To demonstrate a background task, we'll implement a function that will periodically list out what servers the bot is connected to. If your bot's only running on your own server, it'll only list that one server, and that's okay. But if you have a public bot, you might be curious to see what servers that your bot belongs to. First, create a function with the async tag. We'll call this one listServers. It doesn't need any decorators. Start it off with an await client.waitUntilReady. This will ensure that it does not try to perform any actions until it has actually finished connecting. Then create a while loop to make sure the client is not closed. Inside the while loop, we will iterate through the list of servers and print out the names. Then we will call asyncio.sleep. You may need to add import async.io to the top of your file. For this example, we can have it sleep just for a few seconds to ensure it's working properly, but we'll want to set it to something much longer, like 600 seconds or 10 minutes. Now that the background task function has been defined, we need to tell the client to run it as a background task. Right before the call to client.run, let's call client.loop.createTask and pass it the function we created, list servers. Let's run it just to make sure it works. That's all we're going to cover in this video. If you need some more ideas on extending your bot, here are a few ideas. Create a fortune cookie command that returns a random fortune. Create a weather command that will accept a zip code as an argument and return the current weather. Create a dictionary command that will look up the definition of a word. Create a simulated dice roll command that returns a random number. Create a command called remind me, where the user can request a reminder message to be sent after a certain period of time. If this tutorial is too advanced for you, check out some of the beginner Python tutorials on this channel, or check out the previous video. If you want to check out a fully functional artificial intelligence chatbot for Discord, check out Chatty Cathy on the devdungeon.com projects page. You can join the Dev Dungeon Discord server and test it out, or you can run your own. It's all open source and available on GitHub. There is also a tutorial on Dev Dungeon about how to use AML, the AI chat library that powers Chatty Cathy in Python. Check out that if you're interested in learning how the AI chat system works and integrating it to your own projects. Thank you for watching. Please check out devdungeon.com and subscribe to the channel.